We all have an intuitive idea of what a computer is and what it means to compute something. For our purposes, there are several ways in which we could formalize that intuition. Arguably, the most common way of doing this is to talk about Turing machines. And most of you will have heard about Turing machines, but because different people and different textbooks have sometimes slightly different versions of Turing machines, we want to discuss what our version here is. So for me, a Turing machine consists of a tape. This tape is infinite in both directions, so it's infinite to the left and infinite to the right, and it's divided into cells. In each cell, a symbol is stored from some tape alphabet. The most basic tape alphabet contains three symbols. It only contains 0, 1, and a blank symbol. The blank symbol is this square here, this box. But in principle, our tape alphabet could also contain additional characters. The tape is a bit like the main memory of a computer. This is the place where we can store all our information. To read and write from this tape, the Turing machine has a head. The head in every step of the computation points to a single cell of the tape. In each step of the computation, the tape head can move left or right, so it can move one cell to the left or one cell to the right. The Turing machine also has what's known as an internal state. The internal state is one out of a set of possible internal states, Q. You can think of the internal state a bit like the contents of a register in the CPU. So it is also a form of memory, but the important difference between the internal state of the Turing machine and the contents of the tape is that the contents of the tape is not limited. We can store arbitrary large amounts of data on the tape because the tape is infinite, but the internal state can only be one out of a fixed number of possibilities. Finally, the Turing machine has something called a transition function. The transition function tells the Turing machine how to behave, how to actually do the computation. It's sort of like a program almost. The transition function takes the internal state as an input and the character from the tape alphabet that the Turing machine reads at a particular point in time, which is the character that is stored in the cell to which the head of the Turing machine points to. So the transition function has two arguments. One comes from Q, the set of states, and one comes from gamma, the tape alphabet. And it then tells you, based on this information, what the new internal state of the machine will be, so what state the machine should switch to, what character the machine should write onto the tape in the current position. So the head points to a particular cell now, and we replace whatever is written there with a new character. And then the transition function also specifies how the tape head should move. So either the tape head moves one cell to the left, or it stays where it is, or it moves one cell to the right. We can also write this transition function in the form of a big table. And here the rows of the table would be the different internal states, and the columns of the table would be the characters from the tape alphabet. And then we can look up in this table what the action should be. So if I have internal state Q and I read a 0, say, then this table tells me what I should do. The contents of the cell in the table would be something like, oh, you should switch to some state Q prime. You should write a 1 in place of the 0, and you should move your tape head to the right. So to specify a particular Turing machine, we need to specify the tape alphabet. The standard tape alphabet is just 0, 1, blank. we need to specify the set of internal states of the machine Q, and we need to specify the entire transition function delta. Now, here's how the Turing machine does its computation. At the beginning, we have the start configuration of the Turing machine. The start configuration is one where the tape, the contents of the tape, is initialized with the input. So we have some input, which is a 0-1 bit string, and it's just written on the tape, on the cells on the tape. And the head of the Turing machine initially points to the leftmost bit of the input. This is our convention. Furthermore, there's a specific state in the set of states Q, which is the starting state of the Turing machine. Let's call it Q start. So this is how the Turing machine is initialized. The input is written on the tape, the head points to the leftmost bit of the input, and the internal state of the machine is Q start. Now, to perform a computation step, the Turing machine reads the character that the head points to and looks at its internal state. It looks up in the transition function what internal state to switch to, what character to write, and how to move the head. It carries out those actions, switching the internal state, writing the new character, moving the head left or right, or staying where it is, and then the computational step is finished. The computation overall stops once the Turing machine enters in a particular halting state. So let's call a particular internal state Qend, and let's specify that that is the halting state. So once the Turing machine switches its internal state to Qend, it indicates that the Turing machine has finished its computation and is terminating. The output of the Turing machine can now be read from the tape. The output starts with the position where the head points to right now, when the Turing machine terminates, and ends, moving to the right, when we find the first symbol that is not a 0 or 1. So the bit string that's written on the tape, starting at the head position and going to the right until we first encounter a symbol that is not 0 or 1, is the output of this computation. We should mention that sometimes we will use a different type of output, because for decision problems, remember that the output is not really a bit string, but it actually is just a single bit, so just 0 or 1, no or yes. And in that case, we can also define a different way for the Turing machine to terminate. Instead of a single halting state, we have two halting states called Q yes and Q no. And if the Turing machine enters the state Q yes, it means that the computation is finished. We are done, we are halting, and the output that the Turing machine produces is yes, or a 1. If we enter internal state Q no, it means also that the computation is finished, but that the output is 0, or no. Of course, we could achieve the same thing by writing a 1 or 0 on the tape followed by a blank, and terminating the Turing machine, switching to state Qend, but sometimes it's just more convenient to have this different terminating behavior and output behavior of a Turing machine for decision problems. It's just more convenient, and therefore sometimes we'll just use it.